Hi, I'm Brendan, and today we're going to talk about pods and pod lifecycle. So, you know, just as a quick refresher, in Kubernetes, a pod is the atomic unit of scheduling. It can contain one or more containers. It might be something like a web server and a sidecar. And we're not really going to talk too much more about the containers themselves, but what we are going to talk about is what happens when you create that pod. How does the lifecycle of it work within Kubernetes? Well, the very first thing that happens when you create that pod is it goes into a state called pending. Now, what pending means is that the Kubernetes API has accepted your pod. It's ready to go, but it hasn't actually been scheduled onto a machine. You may have a number of different VMs that are running that could have that pod. And there's the scheduler, which is responsible for looking at the various resources, maybe one CPU and 2 gigs of memory, and finding a home for that pod on a particular machine. So once that's happened, once the scheduler has said, hey, this pod is running on, say that this is node 3, once it says the pod is running on node 3, it transitions out of the pending state and into the creating state. Now, what's going on with the creating state? Well, the first thing that's happening is obviously the image needs to be pulled. Now, the image is in some sort of cloud-based repository. Maybe it's in the Azure Container Registry. And so what's happening is the node itself is going out to the Azure Container Registry and pulling the image down to the node. Now, actually, Kubernetes has a preference for scheduling containers onto nodes where the image is already present. So it's possible that if the image is already present on this node, this pull step will be skipped because it obviously doesn't need to happen if the image is already there. All right, so once the container image has been pulled, the container transitions into the running state. And once the container is in the running state, your program is up and running, everything is operating happily. But of course, bad things can happen, and your container could crash. So we have a process, we have a process running inside this container. If it happens to crash, Kubernetes is going to restart it. And so when it restarts, if it restarts too many times, your pod can go into a state that's called crash loop backoff. And what this effectively means is, hey, I've seen your container crash too many times. Rather than fruitlessly restarting it over and over and over again, which takes a bunch of resources and takes CPU for that the kubelet could be using for maintaining other pods, it's actually going to back off. And it's going to actually say, hey, I used to try and restart it immediately. Now maybe I'm going to wait 10 seconds. If that fails, maybe I'll wait 20 seconds, and so on and so forth. So you'll see all of these things when you say kubectl get pods. You'll see this state, pending, running, crash loop backoff. And if you see crash loop backoff, that means something very bad is wrong. Generally speaking, you'll want to look at the logs or other things to figure out why your container is crashing. And you may actually need to fix things in order to get back to a running state. Now, sometimes this happens because a database isn't available and it's a transient problem and eventually you get back to healed. But usually it means there's something that you need to get involved with. Now, there's a few other kinds of error conditions that can happen. Sometimes you'll see things get stuck in pending. And if it gets stuck in pending, that usually means there's no resources. All of these VMs are full. And there are no resources available for your pod to run. The only way to fix that is either to delete some pods, some other pods from your cluster, or to actually scale up the size of your cluster. So if you see things staying in pending for a really long time, you're going to need to sort of resize your cluster or turn on auto-scaling or delete workload, or simply wait and maybe something will stop running if it's a batch job or something like that. Now, another thing that can happen is you could actually give a bad image. So when the VM goes to pull, it could say, hey, I don't know, there's a 404 with pulling the image. I don't know what that image is. When that happens, you're going to get stuck in the creating state and you're never going to transition to running. Again, if you do a kubectl get pods, you may not see this, but if you do kubectl describe, you'll get all of the events associated. So you'll see the events that are associated with this particular pod. And in there, you'll see something like tried to pull image, failed to pull image. Sometimes this happens if you're not authorized. Sometimes it happens if you have a typo in the image name. Kubernetes itself doesn't check with the repository ahead of time before it schedules the container to make sure that the image is available. So if you see things that are stuck in creating, it's usually because there's some degree of problem with the image itself. There's also some more advanced parts of the pod lifecycle. In particular, the most common thing that people do is you can start hanging health events. So you can hang health or ready lifecycle events off the pod. And when you attach these URLs to the pod, what happens is the kubelet is going to actually use these URLs to test to see if your pod is healthy. If it's not healthy, if it returns something that's not a 200, it's going to restart your pod just like it crashed. And it can cause crash loop backoff if it happens too many times. If it checks the readiness, it's going to determine whether it is added to a load balancer or not. There's also a couple of lifecycle hooks that the pod itself calls to help you sort of integrate with other things. And the first one is post start, which is called, that's a webhook that you can register. And that webhook is called immediately after your container starts. And then there is pre-stop, which is called immediately before your container terminates. So if you want to take some action after you've started running, you can register a post-start hook. If you want to take some action just before your container is terminated, you can register a pre-stop hook. The other piece of integration with lifecycle is you can actually, in your pod, define an init container. And this is a separate container image. And what its job is to do is to provide some degree of initialization before the rest of the containers in your pod start up. So if you specify an init container, that container will run to completion first, and it returns a zero, for example. And then all of the other containers inside of your pod will get started up. This is a good way to do things like a schema migration or any other kind of downloading files out of some storage account, any other kind of initialization that you need to do prior to the starting of your pod. I hope that gives you an illustration of the general pod lifecycle and how you can integrate your container with Kubernetes and pods. Thanks.